was a huge group, as you can see. He was the one who was the PI, Dr. Manav Das, Dr. Sapna Narula, and we had the editorial team who had to put together all these results. And Charu Bhanot was the one who was leading that. Dr. Vinay Shankar Prasad Sinha was the natural resources expert. We had Dr. Gopal Sarangi, who was the policy studies, who gave us the insight in how, you know, what all we could do with that, the land that was given to us. And myself, that is, we did the microbial diversity work along with my students. My undergraduate students were interns, so they had a very good exposure doing this work. And Dr. Mohapatra was the, he was the wildlife expert, let's say. He was the one who helped us understand the natural, the fauna and the flora studies of that area. So just to give an introduction, I think these pictures are all moved right now. So we know that we have, the coal is one of the most abundant fossil fuels. We know that. And we also know that we, without it, we cannot do. All the thermal power plants use this for power generation. In fact, nearly a lakh megawatts of power generation in India is done through the coal-based thermal power plants. So coal is a very big reserve. And the mining, as you can see a photograph here, this is what ends up. The soil ends up like this. It is denuded. It is barren. It is totally uninhabitable. And it's the soil that comes up from the depth of the mines is thrown over it, you know, so the big dumps are created, which are totally inhabitable. So we know that the coal, just to give you a brief, as I said, just let me set the stage for this case study, as I'm going to be telling a story. So the stage is here that the Coal India Limited, it was a mining corporation. And from way back, and it is made up of these seven, the list, as you can see, different corporations here, organizations. And it was the Bharat Coking Coal Limited, the BCCL, which is present in Dhanbad, whom we collaborated with to do our forest land restoration work. And a little bit more about BCCL, because as you can see, it affects so many lives there in that area. So it was not just a restoration project for us as much as it was in how to help the population in that place, because they were really suffering. I really need not go into the details of what damage coal mining does to the soil around, to the population around. The air is polluted. There are coal particles. There is nothing growing in inhabitable place. So BCCL, but on the other hand, is of course providing the coal. So it is a very important organization. So it meets nearly half of the prime coking coal requirement of our coordinated steel segment. And not only talk about the thermal power projects. So it has these two major, so it was a private kind of a, it was a public sector undertaking. The government of India took it over in 71 because we know coal became such an important thing. And we've all heard of the coal mafia, of course. So you can see there are so many areas under BCCL. And we were given the Murayad Colliery. Apart from all these, from the Barora area, we were given a Murayad area to work on. I want to just tell you I just want to give you the scale of how much of damaged soil is that there in that area. So the forest land reclamation project that was undertaken by Terry was only limited to a smaller area in Murayad. It is known as Murayad. And the famous Jharia coal field is present in Murayad. And of course, it is the largest and the most extensively developed coal field in India. And this is just one of the 12 that are present in the Murayad area. So a little bit more about Jharia now, because it is a very big basin, as you can see, 38 kilometers. It stretches from one end to the other end and from 18 kilometers from the north-south direction. And it covers nearly 456 square kilometers, just one coal field there. And it is the most exploited. Everybody must have heard of Jharia, of course. And it is surrounded by metamorphic rocks, made of granites, mica, different kinds of rocks. And it has 49 seams with 26 regional seams. So this is from where the coal is extracted, from these 49 seams. And because it forms this mineral-rich corridor, and it has not only coal, but it has other resources such as copper, iron ore, uranium. They're all located in this region. And it was a rural mining area, very poor people, very underdeveloped area. And 110 official coal mines were declared. And what we come to know of, there were around similar number of unofficial mines as well. The land was really exploited. There was no provision, no thought about rehabilitating that land or helping out the people. Unmitigated, this just total coal mining was taking place there. And so there are, Dhanbad district itself, I'm sure many of us have seen so many movies, regarding these coal mining areas. And Dhanbad is very famous for that, of course. So Dhanbad is divided into these two physical regions. So one region is the Jharia coal field, and it is totally polluted, just coal everywhere. And the northern area is little scattered villages. The industrial town is there, and the hills. So I don't know, all these pictures seem to have moved for some reason. In any case, this is the amount of in million tons. You can see the coking coal is 6,000 million tons that has been removed, and we still know that there are another 3,000 million tons there. So that means mining will still go on. The non-coking coal is also in similar amount. So that means no time soon is it going to end. So the mining is going to go on. So keeping that in mind, we developed this project that let us somehow try to restore the land. There are many other restoration projects have also taken place in that area. So we were given this one area. As I said, this is the, as you can see, this is 35 kilometers away from Dhanbad, and it is at a height of 222 meters. And we were given this land to kind of, let's see, how much we could restore it back again. So this is where, if just to give us an idea where we were. So this is Bihar, of course, this is Jharkhand, and this is the place where our project land was given, Mured. And the climate there, as you know, it's very, very hot in the summer. And monsoon, it's a lot of rain in the monsoon, but very little rain in the winter months. And humidity is very high, but still, even though all these conditions were there, where there is water, the vegetation had become very, very poor in these overburdened open cast mines. And the soil also, of course, because the topsoil was all lost, and it was very sandy, reddish brown in color, acidic, and very low holding capacity, because it was all from the really, because as you can imagine, it has been now dug out and being piled up. So the topsoil, the nutrient soil was all hidden away somewhere. It was all, just being topped up by soil from really, let's say, from the center of the earth, really deep soil. And therefore, it was very poor in nutrient content and infertile. And we had this stony, gravelly, sandy soil, all these kinds, loamy soil, as well as clay soil was present. Natural vegetation, because again, due to the mining, it was lost to a large extent. And what natural area that we could see there was some deciduous forest, and it was very low. Again, the forest area was very low, and the trees, they were broad-leafed mostly. And this consists of species like Shoria, that is sal, Delbergia siso, that is shisham, and Madhuka, tamarind, other so many cassia and acacia species. People were doing some kind of agriculture around, and they were growing just the hardier, like say the wheat and some maize that could be grown there. The population was also not much, and very consisted a large 10% of it was small children, again, who were being exposed to all this polluted air and soil. So this is what we got when we began this project. So our broad objective was to somehow provide sustainable livelihood activities to these people who were engaged in open cast mining. And our main objective, of course, was to reclaim this. And through, we wanted to assess through the application of systematic multi-criteria evaluation framework, the suitability of post-mining land use. That if mining is a very important part, we cannot avoid, we cannot ignore, we cannot just let go of it. We need the coal. But how can we kind of make it sustainable, and how can we use that land again after post-mining? So we wanted to now, as another part of our objective, to develop a permanent green cover on these overburdened dumps, and then to also develop entrepreneurship and vocational skill among the members. So it's not just that we wanted to do the, you know, greening. We really wanted to hold hand with the population there to be able to provide them with some kind of entrepreneurship and vocational skills through local, and we wanted to build up local self-help groups. So the methodology that we started with was, we had to, of course, select the site. First of all, we had to prepare that site. We also had to select a reference site. We had to identify a reference site. I'll just explain why. Then we had to develop a nursery, because greening was our main objective. Then how to plant in that our site when we have prepared it, and then to monitor it, the ecological monitoring of that site. So this was our framework, basically. As you can see, I don't know how I could use the pointer here. So this is our framework. So we want to do the first vegetational, the analysis assessment, what is present there. We wanted to identify the forest patches around that area. Then we wanted to take the stakeholder consultations. That is all, anybody who could be involved. That is the officials, the Indian School of Mines, and other local communities. And then we wanted to see what species we could plant. Then we had to develop the nursery there to start, you know, planting, because the soil itself was very poor. Then we wanted to, then from the nursery, wanted to shift it to the overburden dumps. In the meanwhile, with all this, we wanted to study the baseline physicochemical parameters, soil and water. And when the nursery was being developed, we had to do germination tests. And after the plantation, we wanted to, you know, adopt some models. So agroforestry model was going to be adopted, and its monitoring, ecological monitoring would be done using these parameters: soil assessment, heavy metal analysis, vegetable yield production, plantation growth method, carbon sequestration, fauna survey, weather data. So many parameters we were going to study after we did the plantation. And so because for this, we had to set up a field station, which would then continue to do a long-term ecological monitoring. It was not just that we just plant in one go and let go, then leave it alone. So to understand what we should plant, we had to first identify a reference site. So as to understand what could have been there before the mining started. As you can see, mining started way back in, you know, very early 90s. So we identified an area known as the Balmi Forest, which is very near to our project site. So whatever was there, the fauna that was there, we studied that. And we tried to select, based on that fauna and flora, sorry, what we could plant in our project site.
Yes. Participant, please mute.
Yes. Participant.
I guess someone is connected through two devices.
Oh, okay. So to understand that, we made quadrants of 1 meter by meter for herbs, 2.5 meter by 2.5 meter for shrubs, and 5 meter by 5 meter for trees. So we kept it all separate. We took really great pains to understand the herbs separately, the shrubs and the trees separately. Then it was these quadrant size that we chose, 1 meter or 2.5 meter or 5 meter. It was dependent on the abundance of the species that was there in the Balmi forest. And after studying this, after documentation, we realized that we did the IVEI, that is the importance value index. We used this. We saw the Shorya robusta was the most dominant in that forest there, followed by all these other trees. And so we naturally decided, okay, that we also need to. So this is the result, this is the table that we saw Shorya was present in largest amount. And even we did a Shannon-Wiener index test to show that these were present. So this showed that it was mainly, there were also shrubs. A lot of shrubs were present. More of the shrubs were present. So this is because maybe it could be by the grazing activity or by the local people in the region. So shrubs or more herbs, and then we had the trees. So seeing this, then we decided to develop our nursery. As you know, the control soil was naturally the mine soil. It was not at all good for, it was totally nutrient, lacking in nutrients. So we recruited two local nurseries there, and we collected our information. Then we did certain germination tests to, you know, on species, and then along with the consultation, we consulted State Forest Department. We also consulted Professor Babu from Environmental Sciences DU for what would our best species be to be able to grow in such a kind of soil and conditions. So we were suggested with these names, acacia and neem and, you know, cassia and Delbergia and Pongamia species, which you must have seen around the roads in Delhi. A lot of it grows very well. And so using this, and sorry, using these, we did a germination test. So a comparative study was conducted for germination of preferred species in soil samples from Balmi Forest and the Moredi coal site. So we grew them in three types of samples, that is blank, that's our soil, manure, and manure with cow dung. That is, this manure was all other kinds of manure, farmyard manure, other ones. But we, in this category, we added cow dung in a larger area. So blank was only the soil. Second was manure 1:1. And third sample was 1:1:1. So cow dung, manure, and soil. And we had selected 19 species. Like this, finally, we zeroed on into 19 species that we would grow. And six selected species which are available in the local nurseries were further sown in Terry, in the greenhouse in the Terry University, to see the germination potential of the seeds. Two variants of each species were from the local areas. One was grown with mycorrhiza inoculum, and other was as control. So the germinated saplings transplanted in the pits, and the pits are filled with site soil mixed with organic manure. So we wanted to see that just only the site soil, how much, you know, germination would take place there, how much with manure and how much with the mycorrhiza. So six species from Mured and five from Balmi, for Balmi, out of the 19 grew successfully in the blank soil. The soil sample with the mycorrhiza inoculum had eight species which grew successfully for both the regions. Only four and three species grew respectively in the Mured and the Balmi soil, which was mixed with mycorrhiza and the cow dung. So this is the result of our germination tests that we got. So all these species, we can see which germinated well with the mycorrhiza, some without the mycorrhiza, and some in the blank. And Shoria robusta was one of our concerns because its regeneration is very poor in the forest management. That's what we were told. But when we did this multiple treatment with the Shoria, it showed in the university, in Terry University, it showed a positive result for Shoria germination. So Shoria really responded well to the mycorrhizal and the manure treatment as compared to just growing in the blank. So although Shoria is a native species present there. So this is what we were actually given with. This is what we had to restore. As you can see, it's totally barren. And you can see the pits here, coal everywhere. This is the soil. These are some hills there. And a little far away from here is the Balmi forest area. So this is what we had to begin with. So what we did was we divided this project site that we were given into five zones. That is the plantation, we would plant trees there, fruit, we would plant medicinal plants, vegetable, and wetland. We would keep a small wetland as well. This is what we had planned. And so this is the area of what, how we divided it. Plantation, fruit, vegetables we would grow, and medicinal plants also we would grow. We put up some water sprinklers and on the restored lands, and you can see the trucks are still moving there, which are removing, you know, soil for the mining. Those are the trucks. And this is how we were measuring, monitoring the trees that we were planting. And we grew vegetables in the restored land. And so the vegetable zone was of special interest to the project, and vegetable crops were viewed as a potential source of livelihood for the local communities, so that if we could show that the yield is good, and then the local community that was there could add on to their income. So we could have some livelihood, entrepreneurship also we could present. As we said, our aim was to develop a sustainable system, not just plant the trees and, you know, move away. So the result was very good. We had certain, we saw that the yield with mycorrhiza was more as compared to vegetables grown in control, that is without the mycorrhiza. So these, you can see potatoes, onions, triticum, peas, trigonella. So we've grown all this, and we can see this, suppose peas with the mycorrhiza. And yes, we another thing I want to point out here is that we did this for 2 years, so 2017 and 2018. And if I could just point out that if this is, we have increase in the yield over the 2 years. That means what if we had certain amount in the in 2017, it increased in 2018 with the mycorrhiza. It showed an increase, which was quite you know, satisfying to us that okay, mycorrhiza is helping in that barren land. And we also sent out some samples. So this is, as you can see, we are laying the plots for the monitoring. We sent out, some, for example, of the aloe vera, we sent it to the Himalayan Drugs Company so that we could see that, you know, if it is healthy and there is no other toxins or toxic material there, toxic heavy metals or anything like that present in that aloe, and it could be used as medicine. So the test showed that other than the presence of coal particles in the plant extract, no other issue was anticipated. So they said, yes, we could consume it. It was fit for human consumption. So we then carried out the ecological monitoring. That is, this was our strategy for ecological monitoring, that we would do some biological, we would study biological parameters, that is flora survey, fauna survey, and the carbon stock analysis. We would do that. We would, of course, study the diversity of plants and in the flora survey, and study the diversity of amphibia, aves, birds, insects, and reptiles in the fauna survey, and study, compare the carbon sequestration. In the environmental parameters, we would do soil environment. We also did some weather data studies. We did water quality assessment. We did heavy metal assessment. And we did some environmental changes if they were taking place. In the biological parameters, we also did the microbial analysis. So this is all really moved out, I think. In any case, it was, we monitored, we laid out plots. So with and without mycorrhiza, the mycorrhiza is M and the C was the control. As you can see, this is how we began. This is the restoration starting here, just barely, you can see, early years. But after that, we got these results. We got these results, that is growth patterns, we were in different plants. And we saw that the ones with mycorrhiza showed an increase in growth patterns. That was another indicator. Over the period of 2 years, we saw that the mycorrhiza, the plants which were given mycorrhiza responded better than without the mycorrhiza, and these different species responded. Then the study concluded that the growth of Delbergia sisu was found to be highest. As you can see, with the mycorrhiza, it, the girth, average girth was nearly 87 inches, whereas without the mycorrhiza was in the control, was 79, and it was the it was highest in terms of height, girth, and biomass. The high growth rates of Delbergia was due to the presence of the root nodules, which were having the nitrogen fixing bacteria. So that really helped. The nitrogen fixing bacteria added on to its growth. But the Shoria robusta, the sal, also showed, you know, it was a, we accept, you know, anticipated it, but we were trying to overcome it, that the sal could grow better, but it showed the least growth. And Bahuinia also showed a very good growth. So Shoria was the least, and Bahunia was also one of the highest, as you know, even higher than Dalbergia. So this is with the mycorrhiza and treatment, and as you've seen what kind of soil we were really trying to restore. So if you remember the before picture, this is something of the after picture. This is how we are monitoring the tree species we were growing there. And this is the medicinal plants, which were, you know, we have tried to change the landscape of that totally barren area. And percentage survival, if you see, of different plant species which were planted there, the survival rate was nearly 100%, except for Shoria. Again, Shoria with or without mycorrhiza did not show very good results. But the others, Bohemia, that is Kachnar, was really good. Dalbergia was really good. This Gimelinia was good. And if you will see the comparative growth, the analysis of growth, again, this is the something similar result in this bar graph, but we can see the Shoria. So we realized that Shoria planting would not really help, although it was one of the native species. And we used, for the rest, we had used mycorrhiza and we used drip irrigation methods to enhance the growth. Then we began monitoring the fauna. So just a bit about that, we monitored the insecta, that is the insects. And of course, you know, very obviously, if we remove flora, that is, if you remove the vegetation, the fauna dwindles. We know that. So the insects disappear, in fact. And the not only does that contribute, even the amount of blasting and the noise and vibration, the mining operations, you know, the drilling, all that also disturbed the insects. And very few, the abundance totally was reduced. The richness, the diversity was very low for the insects. And we know that the insects play such an important role in, you know, as an ecological service for the sustainability of environment. So hymenopterans, especially ants, are an indicator of a good, healthy soil. So we use that as biomonitoring. And Diptera is another insect, group of insects, pollinating insects. And we use them also because they are the ones that, you know, they go around visiting flowers and they, and especially the economically important crops, that's how they help in pollination. But even their numbers had dwindled. And so this is the regulating services. I just listed them out, that what are the regulatory services that are provided by the class insecta. We really do tend to overlook that. We know that bees are very important. Everybody knows about bees, but it's not only the bees, it's even the ants and the butterflies and wasps, beetles, that are really important. And because they are the ones that move from place to place and they help in the dispersal, they you know, they create these little micro tunnels in the soil, which keep it aerated. And most of all, insects help in the control of other insects, pest population. So, and that is without pesticides, chemicals. So even, you know, we cannot overlook, we cannot truly emphasize greatly, you know, I really need to do that the insects not only are there present to just to pollinate, but they help in other issues such as pest, controlling the pest population. And so they, as is given here, they provide moderation of pH and soil movement. They keep recycling dung, dead wood material, and that's how they form the soil. So they are very, very essential to the ecosystem services that are provided by nature as such. They are a very major part of that. So restoration will, we were hoping, bring back the numbers. So this is how we did some monitoring of the fauna. We used, we took help from the entomology department of the IRI, New Delhi, and we had some physical and manual techniques on land, air, and vegetation were used. So we were hand picking manually, that is, we attracted them in the night using light, and we had collection containers. We used nets, various, whatever was available we could, you know, use. We wanted to use them to collect and study the diversity. And as you can see, these are our young researchers who are doing that with great in enthusiasm and interest. So we found that when we collated the result, we found that the species richness for reclaimed and non-reclaimed sites, that the reclaimed land recorded a diversity index of 2.03, whereas the non-reclaimed land had just 1.47. So there was this difference, of course. A total number of 77 insects, in fact, from the small areas that we were studying, of 11 different taxonomic orders were recorded in this study, which included all cockroaches, beetles, earwigs, you know, butterflies, of course, crickets, the ants, wasps, hymenopteras, the dipterans, and of course, even praying mantis. So this is the diversity index. So you can see in different patches that we had, the vegetable patch, the medicinal patch, the watershed plantation, and the plantation sample site, and the non-restored. Non-restored had the least, and on its own, the medicinal ones also had very little insects. So maybe it's because the medicinal, of course, maybe having some bioactive compounds in them which resist insects. Otherwise, the vegetable patch, the plantation sites, all were really rich in the species. And the least number of species was found in the non-restored. So this again gave us great enthusiasm that we were trying to, you know, the insects, we are getting the insects back in our reclaimed area. And this is how we collected the insects. This is how we indexed them as well. And we saw that the similarity index was very low, 0.36, which means that the collection of insects in our reclaimed and in our non-reclaimed were very different. The amount and the kind were very different. There was very little similarity. So we also then studied, we collected frogs and reptiles. We did a study of the frogs and reptiles. We found different species of frogs and reptiles in our now, which was, you know, getting green, the land that was becoming green in our area. The buffer area is the area which is outside our project area. Study area is the one we have. So we found many, we found a growing number of frogs as well as reptiles. We saw many snakes there. And lizards, these were the, you know, this was, as you can see, increasing number in our area, study area, so that they were slowly coming back with where the vegetation was. So again, just to say this, but naturally, this is what, you know, we really wanted, and I'm sure this is, but the effort that went into sustain that green patch, that green project area, and then to see this life coming back to it, just not just the plants, but the insects, the frogs, the even the snakes, we were happy to see the snakes as well. So that was a testimony in its own self. Then we did the heavy metal analysis because the soil was coming from great depths of the earth. So we studied certain heavy metals, chromium, cadmium, lead, arsenic, and nickel. And because the excessive amounts are very harmful to humans, and the samples were tested in the IRI labs. And we did find, we used the AAS to determine these concentrations. And we found that we have these detection limits here. And we found no arsenic in most of the soil. But we did find some chromium and some nickel and lead, of course. This was in the water that was present there. Then we analyzed the soil, and we could see that in the manure itself also we did heavy metal analysis. We did not find any, so it was not coming from the soil. Then we tested the restored soil, and in 2017, the blank soil from 2015 was tested as reference, and we saw that it had higher levels of most of the heavy metals as compared to the restored soil, and over a period of time. So this meant that certain of the plant species were definitely accumulating these heavy metals. And when we tried to then, we did the heavy metal analysis of the vegetables, so that, you know, that if you're going to consume, are these vegetables that we are growing, are they consumable? Because if they are accumulating these heavy metals, then of course we cannot consume them. So we wanted to test that as well. So we saw that in certain species heavy metal accumulation was there, but most of them proved to be pretty safe, and we could allow consumption of that because they were within the limits, and this is the permissible limits are there. So with the mycorrhiza and without the mycorrhiza control, we really did a lot of these analysis because we did not want the population there to consume these vegetables if they were accumulating heavy metal in them. So they were, most of them were within the limits, except for this Pinacea oleracea, that species was not. We tried to avoid that. And then we did certain soil quality assessment, because soil is the important thing now. We cannot restore the soil. We cannot bring in soil. We cannot bring such tons of soil and, from somewhere else and put it on this overburdened soil. We cannot do that. It is this soil only we have to restore. And as you can see, it is in acres, it's in hectares. We cannot just simply, it's not a small patch that we could just, make it better by bringing soil from somewhere else. So we had to work with what we have. So we wanted to understand the soil quality. And as you know, mining is so destructive. So we were gathering soil in such a manner that we were coning it in, we were collecting it from different quadrants. Then we were coning and quartering this method. And again, taking samples from the mixed soil. We were coning them, taking one sample, again, distributing it so that we get an averaging of the soil. And we saw that the soil quantity was, the soil quality was, this was, the we took, for reference, we took the values that were analyzed by BCCL in 2012, much earlier on. And we saw that the pH was really low. But when we began in 2017, we saw that the, and 2016, we saw that it began to hover around the, around 6.9. We were reaching around 6.9. The alkalinity, we saw the electrical conductivity. We saw the hardness. We saw the various levels of nitrogen and phosphorus, potassium, and sodium, which were not available there. But in our soil samples, they were going up between the 2 years that we were testing that. We also did the carbon estimation. And we used the, for estimating, we used the biomass, the litter and the reclaimed soil. And the tree biomass was estimated by the method given by IPCC in 2005. And so we saw, we calculated the, we took different sample areas, smaller areas, and we did this sampling of the litter. Carbon sec- and we saw that naturally, a higher amount of carbon was sequestered by the green area, which was again an expected result. Then this is where microbial diversity. Now, this is where we, my part came in. My students worked to understand the microbial diversity. And of course, as I've been emphasizing, insects are important, for, other amphibians, other life is important, plants are important, but equally important, and I think even more important, are the microbes which are present in the soil, because they are the one, which really turn the different cycles that are running in our on the planet. So they are very important. So they not only they bring the products, they regulate the benefits that are gotten from the ecosystem services, and they support other production of fuels, etc. So they play a significant role in most of the ecosystem services, and they form part of medicines. They give biochemical, bioactive compounds. They have genetic resources, and they also form food, such as we know mushrooms and other fungi and algae, spirulina, of course, just not really one of the highest, they say, is in nutrient content. And they bring about water purification, and they also bring about disease regulation. And most important of all, they help in the process of soil formation. maintenance of the biodiversity of the soil. They bring about nutrient fixation. We know nitrogen fixation as one of the most important aspect of microbial services. And they bring about cycling of these nutrients. If they go into the soil, sometimes they are unavailable to the plants. So the microbes are the ones that make it available to the plants. So that's why we were wanting to study the microbial diversity. So naturally, we took degraded land, the microbial diversity from degraded land, from the restored soil, that is the soil with only manure, and we took restored soil with mycorrhiza. And we did a pore plate technique along with streaking methods to on normal Luria burtini media, that is a normal enriched media, and we also tried differential media, that is we could extract out microbes with certain properties. So we used the different medias, and then we also did molecular analysis using the 16S RNA sequencing, and we did metagenomic sequencing as well on the soil microbial diversity. So this is the result we had found. This is how we were growing in it how we took soil and isolated initial isolation of our microbes in the nutrient broth, and then we began the spreading. And from different, we kept the three soil samples, the degraded, the reclaimed control, that is just with manure, and the reclaimed with the mycorrhiza. And we got a lot of species. We purified these colonies. We began streaking them. And now we are maintaining them as pure colonies. They have different properties, all of them. This is what we wanted to study. What is the difference between microbia present in degraded land as compared to the one that is present in reclaimed land or with mycorrhiza? So this, as I said, is really moved because I shifted from the system. So this is a picture of sulfur, the bacteria which can utilize sulfur. This is Thiobacillus agarpe. We were growing some, so we got growth. That means these were bacteria which could utilize sulfur. And similarly, these are actinomycetes we got from the control samples. These are a total number of samples we had collected and isolated, and we did gram tests. We have segregated them, which one are gram positive, which are gram negative. And as I said, we did different kinds of selective selection pressures we put in. We grew them in inorganic soil media with Thiobacillus agar, which were Thiobacillus actinomyces. We did, which were nitrogen fixing. So we did a lot of work on these. We collected a lot of samples, and we then went in for the metagenomics. We've also given, at the moment, we've given our these bacteria for the 16S sequencing to identify them. The results are yet to come. But in the meanwhile, we gave samples for metagenomics. So as you can see, the degraded land had very little content of bacteria. There's a picture here which was supposed to be here, which has disappeared. We had the one with the mycorrhiza or the reclaimed land had a much better band. That picture is missing here at the moment. And this was from the degraded land, very faint band. So we really had to collect a lot of DNA material to give it for metagenomics, which was, we outsourced this along with some of our lab members. And the degraded land in itself showed very poor microbial presence, but it did show some. So when we see, so this was after the metagenomics, what they identified was so many species, nearly 2,000, more than approximately 2,000 species in the soil was identified. A lot of core data was identified, of course, and we assumed that it must be, certain man activities that must have been taking place there. But we were more interested in the microbial, and in the mycorrhizal, we were interested. We could see the mycorrhiza, if it was growing there in our soil or not. And we saw the presence of, in the metagenomics analysis, we saw the presence of mycorrhiza. This is from the degraded land, much lesser species identified. Again, as I said, our data for some reason really showed up a lot because of normal human activities that may be taking place in that area. But we saw very little of the other microbial prisons. And this is a comparison we saw, we've done. We did the comparative, we drew a comparative phylogenetic tree to see the difference. And we could see certain fungus, and again, a chordata is somehow coming up, but we could see some proteobacteria in equal amounts in the degraded as well as in the reclaimed, as well as some actinobacteria in the two. But the others were much larger in number in the reclaimed land. Then we did, this is the study of the genes present, the KEG analysis, and we see that the much higher metabolism genes are present in the degraded lands, much more, and even the genetic information processing, but environmental information processing genes were present in the again the degraded land much more, the cellular processes. And this led us to believe that this is again the COG, this is the COG, this is the protein, this is the you know, the biochemical pathways that are being used. And by this analysis, by the metagenomic analysis, what we realized when we studied these individual genes, when we studied these individual genes here, we saw that a lot of genes present in the degraded lands were the active genes that were present in the degraded lands were the ones which are involved in catalase and which are needed for antioxidant activities and toxic activities. We saw certain genes which were involved in arsenic processing. So that means the degraded land gene, the microbes in the degraded lands had these genes active, and that's how they were able to survive in that poor nutrient toxic land, because they had these genes. Whereas the genes that were active in the metagenomics, as we could analyze the genes, the proteins that are present there were the ones dealt with more normal activities, which were more metabolically active. So this was a difference we saw. So that means the microbe, the bacteria, for example, in the degraded land were under pressure, a lot of environmental pressure, whereas the microbes now present in the reclaimed land, these pressures were removed, and they were more abundant. And this is again the proportion we can see. Only a certain kind grew in the degraded land, whereas then this is the Homo sapien activity. You can see is the most in the degraded land. It reduced in the reclaimed land because now it was, there were trees and all, and we had cordoned it off, so people were not coming and going. But mostly when we analyzed all these, we saw even certain genes which was, we are still trying to work out that how come they were there, you know, gorilla genes we found, which was amazing. That so now maybe there was some misidentification here, or they are related to some, you know, primate species which were present there earlier. So this is what I really wanted to just explain. From this, we had a certain amount of livelihood set up camps there, and we used whatever information or, you know, knowledge that we had in our hands to restore this land and restore the people, to provide a better livelihood, to provide schools to the children. We that was not part of, you know, that is not, that was done by the local people under the guidance of the BCCL and Terry University. And we could bring them up. Now we have given them this livelihood. We are still monitoring this. So the people have begun growing their vegetables as well as non-food crops, such as flowers, ornamental plants, and which they are now selling off. And the women especially are being, you know, trained as entrepreneurs to create markets there. So that's what I would like to talk about. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, ma'am.
I'll just try to turn back to the
participants. Anyone wants to ask any question? You can directly interact with ma'am, or you can put your questions in the chat box.
You want to interact with the ma'am, or do you want to post a question? You can directly ask to the ma'am.
Hello. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Sir, I'm Dr. Shweta Kusnesh from MIT University, Rajasthan. Sir, I would like to ask the question to ma'am. What should be the media which is used for the cultivation of mycorrhiza? Is it cultivable on normal culture media?
No. Mycorrhiza is not culturable normally. We need, we have two kinds of methods to grow mycorrhiza. One is the ROC, this is a root organ culture. So you have to have, cultures of roots which are transformed in agrobacterium rhizogenes.
Okay.
And mycorrhiza can only grow on roots, as you know. So that is one way. So culturing of that is very, very, it's a typical culturing. You know, you have to have the perfect media conditions, and of course you have to have the roots, the transformed roots for the mycorrhiza to grow on. And the other method you can culture mycorrhiza is soil. You can collect mycorrhizal spores and you can grow them in pots, and you can have these trap plants, for example, say marigold or sorghum. And you can grow the sorghum along with, you can put the mycorrhizal spores in the soil, in the pot, and that's how then they will multiply. So it's nearly a 3-month cycle. And after 3 months, you can sieve the soil and retrieve the spores.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, ma'am. It was very nice presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yes. Anyone else? Ma'am, I would like to ask one question, please.
Yes, Vikas.
Basically, we have seen this technology that it has delivered really very wonderful results, right?
Yes.
But I was wondering if the same is really going to prove very sustainable for the persons residing there in local societies, since the damage that has been done by the coal mining has already gone down to the level of groundwater. How efficient is this?
See, as you rightly said, it is groundwater, right? So now we handle the problem of the water separately. We also need to now restore the land. We cannot stop the mining. Now the thing is there, what is happening there in Dhanbad right now at this Mured area is, or BCCL has, what they have told us is that they are these seams where they keep mining out the coal. Now what they've done is they've dug the, the ground. They've made these large, huge pits, huge. I emphasize how huge these pits are. So the seams are there around it from where they take out the coal. And after some time, what happens, that coal finishes. So now even they have open pits also. And the soil that came out of the pits is lying on the sides.
Okay.
It is not clean soil. It is polluted with, first of all, it is totally nutrient-free soil that is on top now. So water is a secondary problem. First is somehow to restore the land, and the water purification also, of course, definitely needs to be done. A lot of toxic material is there present in the water. So it is not just that, as you rightly said, just not that one attempt. There are many restoration projects are going on there. So people take up, as projects, these large areas around the mines and trying to restore, bring restoration as much as possible.
Okay.
It has to be a continuing of effort. It is not just that once it's done and, it will continue on its own. And the people have to be involved. So slowly, population is growing. So only a certain part may be taking part in the mining activities. So the rest, have to be involved in somehow getting a livelihood, which is in tune with sustainability, which is in tune with their area, local area.
Yes, sir. And how the legal aspect are there, which are, how compliant it is? I mean, the legal aspect is also there. I mean, the companies are following it or not? I mean, up to which extent they are following it?
See, that is what it is. But now that it is, most of this land is supposedly under government. So we have this, now it is come that, they have to start keep restoring a portion of the land. So, but, as I when I put it in my slide, if there are 110 legal mines, there are 110 illegal mines as well.
Yes.
Are not following the directives. So it is a very big effort. It is not a small thing. It's a very big, as you saw this, it is, I have not really listed out, I should have listed out all the people involved. It's a huge, I sent out a list, but that was just the people who were actively contributing. But BCCL itself, there were the mining, the CMPDI, the mining school, so many people have to be in the local governance has to be involved. Only then can we really restore. And the larger and larger tracts of land are becoming barren. There is no way that we can stop mining. I think India is the third largest coal producing country at the moment after US and China.
Yes,
that's not stop. So we have to think of ways how to, it has taken us 3 years to bring it to this level. And a lot of work, as you can see, different teams doing different parts of the work. And to visualize how to do it. Professor, Sudipto, he really did a great job in leading this whole team.
Yes, so any from participants, if you are having any questions.
Pardon?
I'm just asking one participant to, if they have any question, they may ask.
I was saying that we need youngsters like yours, you and your students and other faculty to really think of.
Thanks a lot, ma'am. And we are really looking forward to you for always having a guidance from yourself. And I know that you're a very generous person and you're very kind-hearted that you have always guided me. And ma'am has always already guided me in my master's. And that was a wonderful experience. And thanks a lot for coming and delivering your talk, ma'am, to us. And it was very, really, very technical and delightful talk. Thanks a lot, ma'am, for joining us.
Thank you so much. I look forward to more people doing work on the, doing work which goes down to the grassroots people.
Yes, ma'am. Of course. Yeah. Thanks again, ma'am. And participants will be having another session at 3:30 p.m. with Dr. Rajat Pandey from Nordic Innovator Denmark. And please stay tuned till 3:30 p.m. Thanks. Thank you, ma'am.
I can sign out. Okay,
ma'am. Bye.